Good morning, Church, and also a warm Trinity PJ greeting to friends and visitors joining our online worship service for the first time. From where we are, let us shut out the noise, worries, and distractions of this world, at least for the next hour or so, and prepare our hearts and minds by hearing from Psalms 84, verses 1 to 4. How lovely is your dwelling place, Lord Almighty. My soul yearns, even faints, for the courts of the Lord. My heart and my flesh cry out for the living God. Even the sparrow has found a home, and the swallow a nest for herself, where she may have her young, a place near your altar. Lord Almighty, my God and my King, blessed are those who dwell in your house. They are ever praising you. And so with our hearts and minds filled with praise and thankfulness to our God, in spite of these troubling times, let us lift our voices in the call to worship so our friends and neighbors too may hear. Let us say the call of worship together. Let us praise God here in this place of worship. Let us stand in awe over his steadfast love.
Your name, O God, like your praise, reaches to the ends of the earth.
So that generation to generation will know that this is our God who loves all men. And now, Church, with one voice, let us all say the opening prayer together. Almighty God, who is worthy of glory, honor, and praise, in this difficult season where we are unable to come together to worship you in the church, as a community of believers, we give you thanks for the reminder that the church is really your people, not the building. For the church was formed around making disciples and multiplying to the ends of the earth, reaching out to those who do not know you by proclaiming the good news of Jesus and serving the least of these is your heartbeat. May we share your heartbeat and listen to your call to serve in our immediate community, caring for the homeless, sex trafficking victims, refugees, and foreign migrants, to go to other countries to proclaim the good news of Jesus, or to support existing missionaries and mission organizations monetarily and through prayer. Holy God, mold us to be a mission-minded community that you can use. Teach us how we can carry out mission work that will be relevant to the people in this day and age. We ask this in Christ's name. Amen.
Hey, people of God, are you tired? Are you weak? Or are you fearful of what's coming your way? So am I. But we can turn our eyes to Jesus and praise him anyway. Praise. Run. Jesus, we praise you.
Sovereign Lord, we give you glory now.
honor. And we give you our highest praise.
Please be seated. We now enter into the time when we hear from God, first from Scripture. But before reading, let us together pray for illumination of the Word. Together, let us pray. As you speak to us this day, loving God, as you reveal your heart of love for all people, including those who do not know you, and even those who reject the gift of Jesus Christ, your Son, we open our hearts to receive your word with obedience. This we pray in the name of Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen. The scripture lesson for today is a single powerful passage from Psalms chapter 2, verse 8. Psalms chapter 2, verse 8. Ask me, and I will make the nations your inheritance, the ends of the earth your possession. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
And now, let us hear from God, who today is speaking through our invited preacher, Brother Andrew Ng. But before this, let us prepare our minds and hearts by singing the hymn of preparation, Be Thou My Vision. We can remain seated.
So God and so God of my Lord. Brothers and sisters in Christ, on this Mission Sunday, we warmly welcome our guest preacher, Mr. Andrew Ng. I will now share some background. Brother Andrew Ng is the founding chairman of a faith-based humanitarian NGO called El Shaddai Center Berhad, more than 20 years ago. Previously known as Migrant Ministry Klang, he has stepped down in early 2020. He has initiated a newly formed loose network called Malaysian Diaspora Network in affiliation with several international bodies. 3 years ago, Andrew Ng set up a social enterprise company named Life to Life, an enterprise project under El Shaddai to empower the marginalized, downtrodden communities towards self-empowerment. He is married to Kim Ng and have two grown-up children, Jeremy and Jessica, and they have two granddaughters. So let us now hear the ministry of the word from Brother Andrew Ng.
Good morning, church. Thank you for the opportunities to allow us to share in some of the work that brings me, El Shaddai has brings me working. On behalf of organizations, we would like to bring you greeting in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. In the process of our work in the church, there are times that we need to sit back and reflect what God is doing at this present time. From that note, I would like to share about some of the trends that God is presently doing so that we are not taken back by the activities in the church, but also to know the God's movements that are taking place. If we look into the history from the time of Christ to the year 1908, the global populations were actually staying at about 1.8 billion. And from 1908 to the year 2011, for the first time, the global populations hit 7 billion, slightly over 100 years. Despite of the Second World War, Two World War, the world population has actually exploded. If Christ decided not to come so early, they predicted by the year 2050, which is short, about 20 plus years from now, the world populations will hit 9.2 billion. What took the time of Christ to the year 1908 for the population to hardly hit 2 billion? Now, it took less than 50 years for the additional 2 more billions of the people coming to the earth. The world is getting very crowded, and the things have been changing tremendously. This is some of the changing trends that are taking place because of globalization. Few of the key points that are taking place is the advancement of technology, something that we can't deny. Right from the time of 100 years ago, the discovery of steam engine, to the present time, the progress of technology are taking an unprecedented pace. And of course, we come with the medicines that allow human beings to have a long piece of life, a healthier lifestyle. The third areas that the church, the world is going through is actually the transmigrations. The people are moving from one place to another. Globally, about 10% of the people are moving from one place to another, predominantly through the economic reasons. People who are poor started to move. People who are hungry will start to move. The effect of globalization, I like what this man has stated. He says that God does not put us in this time in all the curse that we, whereas the wind of change is coming, but to sail the ship. We will not stop the gathering storm of globalization because it's coming at us. We will, with God's help, harness the force of globalization so that those who are very forced take us in the directions God wants, not in the directions they're trying to blow us away. There are three routes that the people are moving, three very different routes. One of the great movements that are taking place that people are migrating is actually from South America to North America, from a poor country to a richer country. The second route that are taking place is actually from people from Middle East and from Africa trying to flee into Europe, trying to earn a living because people are hungry. The third route, surprisingly, there were also a lot of these people are moving in and trying to cross over to Malaysia to Australia. Somehow Malaysia becomes a hub. I think maybe because of the easy access of visa, many of the countries will have an access-free visa or visa on arrival into Malaysia. And from there, they'll find figures and find ways to go over to Australia. And unfortunately, many are got stuck in Malaysia and couldn't go further than that because Australia do not give them the visa to move forward. Now, in order to understand a little bit about the work that is going on, we need to at least understand from the biblical perspective what God has to say in the Old Testament and also in the New Testament. I've just got three of the verses that is taken from the Old Testament, how God has reminded Israelite when they were in the Promised Land. God has reminded the Israelite, taken, let's say, from the book of Leviticus chapter 19, verse 33 to 34. God has reminded the Israelite, when the aliens that live among you, do not mistreat them. You must treat them as one of your native poor. Love him and you yourself as a reminder you yourself were once in Egypt, when you were also an alien. Another verse is taken from, is actually from Deuteronomy, chapter 24, verse 17 to 18. It says, do not deprive the aliens or the foreigners of justice, or to take the cloak of the woman's as a pledge. Remember, you were once a slave, you yourself, and how you have been treated. And we have to also likewise how to treat the people that is around us. The third passage that I will take from is actually from the book of Zechariah, chapter 7, verse 9 to 10. It says, administer true justice, shows mercy and compassion to one another. Do not oppress the widow or the fatherless, the aliens or the poor that is in your heart. Do not think of evil among them. Interesting, the word alien has been constantly been emphasized in the Bible. And of course, there is not words that's used as migrants, the refugees, or the irregular migrants. Because at the time of the Old Testament and the New Testament, that word has not been used very commonly. But in the Bible, they are either used as sojourners, foreigners, or the alien that is now means. So what God is trying to remind the Israelites, even right to our time, is that we have all these people around us, even right into the Old Testament time. It's not something new that the church will find it very strange to have. And I think there is no coincidence that these trans-migrations, millions of people are not flocking from one place to another because of poverty, because of survival. Now I'd like to quote from the book of Acts, chapter 17, verse 26-27. We have to look at it from this perspective. What is God doing? And you say that he has made from one man, which is Adam, every nation that dwells on the face of the earth. And he has determined their pre-appointed time and boundary of their dwelling. So they should seek the Lord in the hope that they might reach for him and to find him and through him, which is never far from any one of us. It's God that predetermined the time where they are at the present time and at present era. And I believe that if God has placed them in our land, there must be a good reason. And the church will need to respond instead of the general response to say that, oh, they're coming here, they're taking away our work, and they are causing a lot of trouble in our land. Interestingly, it's not the migrants that cause the most of the trouble. We foreigners, they know of their limitations. And we at least need to know what is the diaspora population that are in Malaysia. When we termed it diaspora, I'm trying to define it together with the refugees, asylum seekers, migrants, and also the irregular migrants. In the layman terms, usually we call that as illegal migrants. But in the United Nations eyes, they are considered as undocumented migrants. Now, Ministry of Health Resources at one time claims that we have an estimate of 2 to 2.1 to 2.2 million legal migrant workers. No one for up to at this present time has not known how many are those with no documents. Except for one time during the 2017, one of the debate in the day one Raya, the Human Resource Minister, Dr. Sri Richard Wright, made a passing comment that in Malaysia, we have an estimate about 6.7 million migrant workers or labor, which includes the legal and the illegal. Nobody for sure know how many, but we know that for every one legal migrant workers, there could be two or even 2.5 of these people with no documents. Can you imagine? The number of migrants over in Malaysia is about the same size of the Chinese in Malaysia's population, which is about 22%. On top of that, the United Nations at this present time has registered an estimate of 190,000 refugees in Malaysia. Not includes those who are asylum seekers, which means the United Nations would need to at least verify another 50,000. At this present moment, we were told that those who are going down to the United Nations to get their paper to be verified to say they are persecuted by the country, the appointment time, just to have the first interview, could be as long as 2 to 3 years. At that time, they were considered as irregular migrants and no help was ever given to them, even when they are running away from the country, because over this time, the United Nations globally, the populations of refugees has actually exploded. 10 years ago, the global refugees population stand at about 40 million. 2020, or around the 2021, right to the latest statistic, the United Nations globally has registered about 82 million refugees globally. The world is going through tremendous pain at the moment. Intolerance, especially at this COVID-19, the intolerance is even getting worse. Now, compounded on this, the Ministry of Health Higher Education at one time was commenting by the year 2020, which was actually last year before the COVID time, that we are targeted to bring in about 200,000 international students from all over the world. In fact, 2019, they registered about 180,000 of international students coming from 136 countries, and predominantly coming from Middle East. We want to mention about the business expatriates and the businessmen or the professionals that are in Malaysia. In terms of the people who are in Malaysia, it's a lot. So we have to at least understand. The migrants in Malaysia, which are coming from all the different countries, predominantly from 12 countries. And if you look carefully into a lot of these people who impacted with the refugees category, predominantly these people coming from the 1040 windows, they're very unreached. And these are the people that the missionary will have difficulty going into their country. And God has to scatter them out, especially in 2011, after the Arab Spring. There is a huge outflow of all these people to different parts of the world, and Malaysia is actually one of the recipients of the people who are running away from their life. Late 1999 or early 2000, a small group of us decided to say that we want to do something about migrants that is around us. That was about slightly over 20 years ago. Al Shaddai was formed, where formerly it was called as migrant ministry plan, because we have actually moved away only working with legal migrant workers to across the board all the other diaspora that are in Malaysia. we'll deem that as a discipling nation at our doorstep. At the end of 2019, we registered an estimate of 1,600 over students, not only in Klang itself, but we have actually brought spread forward to all the other parts of Malaysia, to the extent up to East Malaysia, in particular in Sabah. To date, we have registered an estimate of 2,000 students. I'll try to explain to you how that could be possible with a small setup like this. And I will tell you the model that we're using, because we know that unless we change, we will continue to stay in the old conventional way of trying to do mission work. Albert Einstein has once said, you know, we always try to do the thing, same thing again and again and again, and expect a different result. In order for us to change, we need to at least know of the available training and resources that are available to us, and use every avenue to see that the gospel will not only stuck with the limitations that we have. I like what William Carey has once said, you know, if you want to do God's work, we must attain God's science work, and we must also expect God's science work. When we expect in God's work that we are doing, that we want to, we will not do it with our own human effort. We will want to definitely want to do it. Only God can do that. On the year 2017, in November, the school has hit the maximum. Incidentally, all our school are held inside different church premises in Klang. To those who are more familiar with Klang, there was a cluster of church in Klang town itself, where 3-4 churches building are located close to one another. That allowed us to use the church premise on weekdays when the church is not having any activities. And during the weekends, the church activities will continue to go on. With that 4 premises, we have roughly registered for 650 students. We were asking, what is God wanting us to do? The impression that we're given is, do not stop there. You should also think of avenue to expand the work. 2018, we started our auxiliary school, which means that we take the school into the heart of the community where they are staying. Within the short span of about 3 years, we have actually expanded about 4 or 5 other auxiliary schools, which is about 7 to 10 kilometers away from the main school itself. In totality now, we have roughly about 1,200 students only in Klang, right from kindergartens right up to secondary 5, which our students are taking on the Cambridge pathway, IGCS. We are happy to say that, in fact, last year, 8 of our students were actually going for the IG exam, all passed with flying colors. So we believe that if you give people a chance, they will be able to do well. So this is the second model that we do, is actually to set up auxiliary, which is kindergarten and level 1, so we conduct it in the communities, providing free education to this group of people with a very, very minimal cost. And even for that, we've been requested several times by the madrasa, the Muslim Religious Center, which is the Ringa Madrasa. Because a lot of time when the student would want to come over to join us, they may have to wait for maybe a year or so, because we're full. We have come to the stage that we could not even cope further, but the waiting list has been very long. First time that we did our first school right inside the Muslim Religious Center, that is in Johan Setia, where the madrasas opened the center for us to use, where in the morning we'll conduct the normal school class, in the afternoon they have the religious study. I always believe that if you want to take the gospel to their people, you got to go to the very heart of their community. The same way, if you want to take the lion's cup, you must prepare to go into the heart of the lion's den to collect the children. And they are the ones who open up us because of the years of the engagement with them, the level of trust that has been given. At this present moment, we are working in partnership with 6-7 other madrasa schools who will actually open up for us to use. These are the invitations they have called us to go in. And other than giving them the 3 basic syllabus, which is math, science, and English, we always incorporate in moral study. And I believe that you should at least know how does our moral study will go. It's actually a biblical story. Intentional discipleship, right from the heart of these young children. We're teaching this story, is part of the story telling time that we will want to share with them. And we bring the Bible story right into the heart of their community. And they will love to hear story. And we said this is coming from a holy book. And we tell them the story of Jesus about a parable. Whoever plant the first seed in the heart of these people will see the harvest to come in the years to come. Because if you want to make a change in the community, you must learn to build critical mass. We are praying now for 6,000 students, not 600. And we know that if you want to reach them, you need to have a different strategy to see that more of these people can be reached. A day will come. We may not receive the harvest. 20 years down the road, the young children will grow up to be adults. They are going to make a decision. They are going to say that these are some of the options I will choose not to follow. Even with the religious, because they have education and they know who are the other God they are going to worship. The third model that we use is actually to set up an online literacy class targeting at all those who want to learn English, because one of the advantages about modern technology, because everybody holds a handphone, a smartphone, and for them to at least conduct a class, we will look for a community contact point. They will recruit the students, and every student that they recruit, they will have to collect the 10 ringgit from them. And every student they recruit, we will also give them another 10 ringgit. So they will go around to recruit all these students in the group of five, and we have the teachers teaching them online, 1 week twice, 45 minutes, and they will learn to speak English because they need to learn in the group so they can practice with one another. And we have a lot of opportunities to do community engagement and using Bible to teach English to this group of people. We have no qualms, and everybody also wants to learn. And we have the community to do the connections with us. In the process of the lockdown, we continue to keep on expanding because there was a request. Early last year, we have a request from the Champa community in Kuantan, and we went there and set up a school for them. We always tell them, they must provide the hardware in order for us to go in to give them the software. This is model number four, where we now will have to collaborate with the community. The community will run the school, and we will come and provide the trainings, holding the hand of some of the teachers who are having some basic educations, and give them the tools to use it. They only have to facilitate because media has given us the accessibilities using every avenue, because educations can come online. And we only facilitate it from afar, where the teachers can teach it from Singapore or from Australia, and even from Malaysia, maybe from Kuala Lumpur, they can teach the students that are in Kuantan or even Kota Bharu. So what they do is actually they have to rent a place, set up a school, get all the students, collect their own school fees. We will go there and give them a small stipend, every teacher, and then cost about 300 to 400 ringgit. And the others, they will have to collect it from the student themselves. They will have to collect. And if they want to teach well, they make sure that the student continue to learn and they continue to provide the fees. And they also have to upgrade themselves because the students will have to upgrade. In one way, that will help the teachers to perform well. Because over the next 2, 3, or even 4 years, they will be a very good teachers. Because we use method to teach, not people focus. Because if you look for teachers, it's always a challenge. Where to look so many teachers when you want to do it. Hold the hand of this community and they will learn along the way. Last year, mid of last year, we started to launch out to Sabah, because when we look at the areas deep in our heart, Sabah has the highest number of irregular migrants. They estimate about 1.2 to 1.5 million irregular migrants are in Sabah alone. So it is for every 2 Sabahan, there will be 1 irregular migrants in their midst. So it's a huge number. Over there, in fact, we started also the same model where we go into the heart of the Banjang and the Solo Kampung and set up a school over there in the heart where they are staying. And we hold the hand of this teacher and walk along with them. So we bear very little cost because they have to collect the fees themselves. And our teachers will go there, it's only to facilitate, not to teach for them. They have to take ownership. Always remember, when we go to any communities, we want to work with them. We don't want to go and do for them. One of the greatest change that we want to see, that if they are not interested, it's fine. We just leave. Because there are millions of other people who are deprived of education. They are looking for people who are willing to go into help. So when we go in as a volunteer, missionary teachers, you can bring a lot of gospel into their heart. Intentionally, we go there, we also tell them story. One of the greatest joy that I've seen is we are using oral Bible story, telling story, and they will then go and tell the others. It also reminds us during the time of Jesus Christ, why Jesus all the time was using parable to tell this group of people. Because at that New Testament time, a lot of these people are illiterate. So in order to disciple them well, is to use Bible story. So when they learn the Bible story, they can go and tell the others. No problems. Even when they're illiterate, they can still do that. And also one avenue that we're looking to is actually through the mobile medical clinic, using medical knowledge to go into new communities to open up, to gauge the community's need. At the present moment in El Shaddai, we have roughly about 20 different nationalities that we are engaging with. All this opportunity is because of the education we're providing them. And 3 years back, El Shaddai actually started up a social enterprise under a different company called as Life to Life, from one life touching another, because we also want to see that they can sustain themselves and giving them the opportunity to earn a living of their own self, instead of going there to do relief work. One of the works that we always do not do is actually relief. We only do rehabilitations and development. Education is long-term development. Rehabilitation is holding their hands to see that they can learn to earn a living their own self. One of the classic examples that we have actually done is through skill enhancement, which we have just started beginning of this year, an aircon electrical, and soon to launch also the same time electronics training. We just have the first batch of students who have finished their aircon service training and electrical, basic electrical. And we are supposed to take in the second batch, but because of the lockdown, we have not been able to do much. And young teenage children, we know that it will be quite difficult for them to go back to the school. When you have 3 to 4 years of education at the age of 15, 16, or 17 years old, what we want is actually to provide them a skill. With that skill, they will be able to earn a living of their own self. Not only on theory, but could take them out into the field and let them know, because you have an experienced aircon guy who will actually walk along with them. So not only in the classroom, but also in the field itself. Another area is that we have actually ventured into on the big scale is actually fish farming, urban fish farming. We know that in urban areas, to breed a large quantity of fish is something impossible. So we're using technology, using microbes, microorganisms to break down the fish, the waste, in order that the waste will go back with the clean water again into the fish pond itself, using a very small space to breed the fish. And we will want you to see a 2 minutes video slide about the fish being taken care of by the Syrians and the Cubans.
Life to Life is a social enterprise arm of El Shaddai Center, a registered NGO in Malaysia. We developed this fish project with the help of our mentor to ensure sustainable and dignified livelihood for the diaspora community. All our profits from the fish project are channeled back to expanding the project and the community themselves. Our patin fish is different from those that are available in the market, because we feed our fish with good feed. We use animal fish feed, which are about 28 to 32% protein, and they are chemical free. So that's why our patin fish are very good and healthy.
Another area that we're embarking on is actually the rabbit farming, which the time to come, we will at least wanted to show you some of the products that we have actually produced. The third area that we're actually now doing is actually grapes cultivating, tropical grapes, where we will produce grapes that were good enough for consumption. The grape is actually matured, already coming to a year. We're supposed to do the bark grafting, but because of the accident and the lockdowns, we have to delay the bark grafting. But the stem itself has to be matured at least a year. Now they have actually produced grapes, but that grapes are not for us to consume. That grape is the proof that this particular plant actually been growing well. We have 12 plants. We believe that in the time to come, we should be able to produce about 50 to 100 kilos of grapes per season. It depends on the maturity of the plant to see that they will produce even more. One area that we're also working on is on bakery, that we work in partnership with one of the bakers who are actually producing quality bread all this while. And they have actually set up a branch plant that is working on a partnership, 75-25 partnership, where our refugees are at the present moment working over there, producing quality biscuits for the market. We will slowly try to expand the work where we can get in more refugees to go into work. And one of the project that we embarked, which has been highly successful, is actually the sewing project that is working among the Afghans community. We started the work in 2019, where we produced high quality clothes for several boutique companies. But because of the lockdown, we find that, we've come to a time that, you know, we have not been able to do anything. God has been very gracious to every one of us. During the time of the lockdown, we are one of the largest producers of PPE for the hospitals all around Malaysia. Because at that time, nobody would dare to do out. All these sewers within the Afghan community at that one time were supporting 40 over families, producing the PPE for the hospital 12 hours a day, 7 days a week. And within that 3 months, they produced like thousands and upon thousands, because at that time, it was something that it was so urgent and everybody was looking into it. We know that this has been over, and they have the second phase, they were actually producing face masks. We have a lot of company and NGOs actually giving us order to produce face masks. Thing is now settled down. We're now moving back into boutique manufacturing again, because a lot of these boutiques are now selling online. We are in the process of looking into one of the company who want to help us to upskill into going into productions. We are working into a big company who actually want to invest, knowing that this is an avenue they can do their CSR. Now, two big projects that actually birthed forth from COVID-19. One is actually called Emergency Relief Fund. As I've said in the past, that we have not been very strong in doing relief work, because we believe that only go and give handout would not be our forte. But because of the lockdown, and we find that there are people who really crying out for help, over the past 1 year, we have fed roughly over 5,000 families, 5,000 to 6,000 families. Some have been one time, some have been a couple of times, especially for those that are in plan. That we are closing, working very closely, constantly we're providing provisions. Not because they do not want to work, but because of the lockdown, none of them are allowed to go out to work. Another area that we have embarked on is actually the e-trainings that we're talking on. We are, in the moment, trying to move into areas using internet as an avenue to do engagement. Now, a lot of time people have started to ask, what are all these work that you're doing, the social work? what is the result? Indirectly, we have been asked, what's the fruit like? I share with you one or two of the testimony that the student have now gone overseas, which has actually wrote back. Somehow, we do not have a chance to keep track with all the students that have gone out. But occasionally, we have one or two students who wrote back and thanking us for the pathway we have actually charted for them when they're over in Malaysia. And because we laid them a good foundation, so when they go overseas, they will have the opportunities to earn a living, go into university. Now, one particular person that I would like to look in, share with you is this Rohingya boy that was actually in our school for 6 full years. When he was actually coming to our school, he was already 9 years old, along with his younger brother. Now he's in the United States. His name is called Samso Alam. The testimony when he was writing this letter to us, it really, really touches. I will not dwell on it, but you can look it through the screen. But the last part that is written, he said that, I pray that the love of God, the grace of Christ, and the sustaining breath of the Holy Spirit is with you now and forever. For a Muslim, written to a Christian organization like us, speaks well of why has he learned this word, giving a benedictions, giving his benedictions to the church like us. We're not too sure where is he now, but we believe for sure a people like this, a day will come. They may even come back to bless the community. And I believe for very sure he's not going to be a same person that he is when he leaves the country. He is going to bring blessings to them. Another example that I would like to share with you is about 2 years back, we received an anonymous money of Australian 1,000 from a lady in Australia whom that we don't even know. So when we wrote back, we tried to at least explain how did she come to know us. It was actually one of our students who was being awarded for a scholarship. And she wanted to thank the school that actually taught her when she was in Malaysia. Amazingly, she write a testament. What she was saying is, not only I learned a lot from the school, in Al-Shanai School, I also have a lot of fun. It was one of my most fun days that I have. As a refugees, you see, a lot of time people in our school, they don't like holiday because they have to cope up at home. When they come to the school, they have so many people that come together, they can talk, they can interact, irregardless of any nationality that they come from. To them, a lot of them in Malaysia, we take it for granted. But to them, it's such an important avenue of their life that they're growing up. The children need an avenue to grow. Now, working on all this work, one of the greatest components in Al-Shanai is actually our field people, which we call them as LED, L-E-D, which means lead, evangelize, and disciple. And we have about 30 or more people that is in the field, Malaysians, fellow Malaysians from young to about our old age, who actually some of them has given up their career just to be with us in order that they want to see the great commissions to be fulfilled. We have the privilege to walk along with them to see that they will continue to fulfill what God has actually implanted in them. We become like a facilitator, a platform for these people to engage in different areas of life. Of course, in our kind of life, we will occasionally have visitors which you will deem it as a threat to every one of us. 2 years back, I was being visited by the religious authority of Malaysia from Selangor, who has received complaint that we are trying to proselyte among the Muslims. Because you have to understand, in Klang itself, or rather, in totality of our number of students that we have, more than 80% are actually Muslim. Can you imagine of this Muslim going in and out of the church building? They're bound to some local lodge complaint, wasn't very happy. And surprisingly, they are rational people and they just want to know what we are doing. The pictures were later shared with you. Actually, when they come over, in the initial stage, they were talking in a very threatening manner. But when we stand firm, and tell them who we are, that we're humanitarian workers. We're helping them to provide them education. We're not there to do anything sinister. They know. And they know that if you are not a pushover, they also will learn to sober down and learn to talk facts with you. I said that if they are happy, if not happy, they're free to take all the students into the mosque themselves. All of them quiet. They know that for thousands of students, there's no way they're going to do it. Neither does the government really bother. And of course, last year, another complaint was launched. I've been visited by the Deputy Superintendent of Police, which is a special branch from Selangor. They are very kind people. A team of them came over, we took them out for lunch, and the interviewer actually in the restaurant itself. It took them about 3 hours, three, four officers meet up with me, try to understand some of the work we're doing. Their only concern is that we will be a public disturbance to the community. But if we are not, they don't even bother. And they know that what we're doing. And if you try to be nasty, instantly the school that we're having in Klang is just beside the police headquarters. In and out, they know. And they also know that these are people from non-Malaysian citizens, and we have the endorsement from the United Nations. If they're not too happy, then just tell them, please launch a United Nations and close down our school. None of them actually were there to do that, because they know it will be difficult for these children who are running around, causing more nuisance to the people, to the Malaysians. One of the areas they have set up, beginning 2020, before the lockdown, I've actually initiated a new work called as Malaysia Diaspora Network. It's a network where national bodies from different parts of the countries will have a share of the resources. And along with it, we also provide some form of training. The whole purpose of this network is to link up churches or individuals doing the same work in different parts of the country, giving them an opportunity to share notes, giving information, some training they provided, some of the resources are available, are freely offered to them. From there, we also provide a training called as Diaspora Mission Training. Taken from the past 20 years of experience, we also want to share with the church, there's something that we can do alone. Not because we want to expand our work, but rather to see that this work are taken on by the church. For West Malaysia alone, we have roughly about 5,000 churches. With the populations of about 4% of the West Malaysians are Christians, I think the church can do something. With so many of these people are so close to us, missions can be done right at our doorstep. Book of Psalms, chapter 2, verse 8, it says that, ask of me, and I will give you the nations as a inheritance, and the end of the earth as your possessions. We must dare to ask, and God will provide you the nations. And the nations is now at our doorstep. A small organizations like Al Shaddai are reaching to 20 different nations. We can do a lot. That's where the partnership we need to come from. Thank you for your claims, for allowing me to share.
In response to the word of God this morning, let us now together affirm our faith. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The day he rose from the dead, he ascended into heaven and seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
It was.
Now, let us enter into a time where we offer our gifts and offerings to Almighty God. Let us pray together the offertory prayer. God Almighty, the physical and spiritual needs of the world outweigh the number of people who are willing to sacrifice their life to serve you in the mission field. As I give to you this day, perhaps you are calling me. If so, give me the courage to say, "Yes, Lord." May your will be done in my life and the life of every member of the church. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Let's enter a time of Holy Communion and hear these words of invitation. Christ our Lord invites to his table all who love him, who earnestly repent of their sin and seek to live in peace with one another. Therefore, let us confess our sin before God and one another. Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your love. We have not loved our neighbors. And we have not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us, we pray. Free us for joyful obedience. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Hear the good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners. That proves God's love toward us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. Glory to God. Amen. Let us now offer one another signs of reconciliation, love, and peace. The peace of God be with you.
the great thanksgiving. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to our Lord, our God. It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy are you and blessed your Son, Jesus Christ. By the baptism of his suffering, death and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. On the night in which our Lord Jesus gave himself up for us, he took bread, gave thanks to you, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When the supper was over, our Lord took the cup and gave thanks to you and gave it to his disciples and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, pour out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these almighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ offering for us, as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Our Heavenly Father, we beseech you that you please pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here at our homes and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. And now, with the confidence of children of God, let's pray together the prayer that our Lord taught us to pray, saying, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power and the glory, forever and ever. Amen." Blessed is in Christ, the body of Lord Jesus Christ, broken for you. Take and eat it and be thankful. The blood of Lord Jesus Christ shed for you. Take and drink it and be thankful.
Let's go to God in prayer.
Let's pray.
Our gracious God, we thank you for reminding us of Jesus. We thank you for the cross. We thank you for what Jesus has done to redeem us and to save us. And as we come with thankful hearts, help us, Lord, to love you with all our heart, mind, soul, and strength. And help us, Lord, to love one another and love our neighbors. For this we pray and ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
Church, as we go forth to live for God, let us make the closing hymn of dedication our anthem. All hail the power of Jesus' name. And let us remember this song in the coming days ahead.
Service to a close, let's seek the face of the Lord together. O God, our Father, we bless you, we praise you and thank you, for you have, O Lord, enabled us to set aside the time today to seek your face in worship. We thank you, God, that you are reminding us that you are a God who loves the world. You're a God who is on mission. Even as we are reminded of what your son Jesus said, peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, so I sent you into the world. So God, our Father, we know that you sent your son Jesus into this world to save the world, to die for our sins. That God, through the death of Jesus, our sins can be forgiven. And as we put our faith and trust in Jesus, we become your children. We thank you, O God. And you have saved us to be your children. And you have also, God, given all of us a mission. So, Father, help us to know your heart. Help us to know, O God, your love for people. that we too, O God, will do what you want us to do. That we, O Lord, will be your hands, will be, O Lord, your feet. We, O Lord, will reach out to love people as how you want us to love them. We bless you, God, Father, we praise you and thank you. Again, Father, we do ask, O God, for your peace to be over our country, Malaysia. In this time of pandemic, in this time, O God, of a political instability, in this time, O God, of our people in great suffering and pain, Father, we just pray, God, for your peace so far, your peace to be over the nation of Malaysia. Let your kingdom come upon Malaysia. Let your will, O God, be done in Malaysia. Thank you, Father. As the people call out to you, O God, may you bring help and relief unto them. We bless you, Father. We thank you. Father, we just thank you, even as you enter this new month of August, with all its known and unknown, we have this confidence and hope that you, O God, are with us. Help us, O God, to hold on to you. You are our good shepherd. The Lord, you will lead us and guide us. Thank you, Father, you will not leave us alone. We bless you. We thank you. And now, receive the blessing of the Lord. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and grant you peace. And the peace of God that surpasses all understanding, guard your heart and your mind in Christ Jesus, now and forevermore. Amen. Amen. God bless.
Brothers and sisters in Christ, dear friends, we extend a warm welcome to our guests and visitors to our worship service for the first time. You know, it's always that we are truly delighted to have you here with us this morning. If you want to know more of our church, please log on to our church website at www.trinitypj.com, or you can email us to askask@trinitypj.com. We truly give thanks to God that people have visited our church website and inquired, you know, about our church, for example, like our baptism or job opportunities and other church programs and ministries. So we are truly delighted, and I want to encourage you to please visit our church website or to know more about our church. Secondly, I want to encourage you to register for our church webinar, coming webinar called Praying the Psalms, Holy Prayers to Help Us. It will be held on Friday, 6th to Saturday, 7th of August. The guest speaker for this webinar is Bishop Dr. Gordon Wong, Bishop of the Methodist Church in Singapore. For more information, please refer to the WhatsApp message which was circulated yesterday, or please log on to our church website. To those who have been attending our church regularly and have made an important decision to be baptized and confirmed as a member of the church, please be informed that there will be a new baptism, confirmation, and membership course commencing on the first week of August. I want to encourage you to sign up for this 15-week course. And for further inquiries and to register, please visit our church website or email at membership@trinitypj.com. I have been announcing about the Alpha Online for a few Sundays. So please take note that the Evangelism Committee and the Alpha team is organizing this new Alpha Online for the second half of 2021. And this will commence the first week of August, coming soon. We have two English Alpha Online on Wednesdays from 8:30 p.m. to 10 p.m. and Saturdays 3:30 p.m. to 5 p.m. And also one Mandarin Alpha Online on Wednesdays from 8:30 p.m. to 10 p.m. So I want to encourage you to invite your family members, friends, neighbors, colleagues, others to attend our Alpha Online. And so for more information on Alpha, please visit our church website. Alpha Malaysia is organizing Alpha Workplace Online on 21st and 28th August. The early bird registration ends on 2nd August. So now let us watch this video slides from Alpha Malaysia.
We must have a kingdom purpose and a spiritual vision beyond Sunday church if we are to impact the world. The spiritual atmosphere in the workplace is more open than ever. The opportunities for the gospel to advance are greater than before.
I realized that when I began to have a change of perspective and brought God to work and removed that mindset between the sacred and the secular, and I bridged that gap, I realized that the power of God has now become so real in my life in the workplace. It's no longer about me praising God on Sunday. It has gone beyond Sunday.
And then one day it just suddenly dawned on me that I was not even 10% as concerned about souls as I was about achieving sales target. Mm. One of the most important ways of bringing God to work is to share the good news, and Alpha is such a wonderful tool for this purpose. Mm.
Every human being was told, right, Psalm 8, literally rule, take dominion over the world,
right? And God can continually call us into different arena, into different spaces of our lives, through our crafts, our ability, and the talent that God has given to us.
We provide income opportunities and skills training. So when I decided that that's what we would be about, every decision we make is about, does this give someone a skill that they didn't have? Because I have a belief that no matter our education level, we can all learn.
I believe you need good pedagogy to teach. And I believe in the pedagogy of the heart. What this implies is that to teach, you definitely need that subject matter expertise. You really need to know what you need to do, whether it's digital, non-digital, project-based, whatever interventions you're doing. But above that, you need to do it from the heart.
My dear friends, during this phase one of the national recovery plan and the spread of the Delta variant, please stay at home or limit your movements. Do stay healthy, stay safe, and please stay connected with one another, because we are indeed a church body of Christ. So see you next Sunday, my dear friends, and have a wonderful week. Amen.